Chukuma, when you call me Chukuma.
Could you tell him when the music plays, not to...
Yeah.
Okay. Does it mean something?
It means God knows.
God knows. I like that.
When the music plays, don't talk. That's the intermission.
This is WHLC. I'm your host, Johnny Jones, also known as John Jones. Today we have two guests. Our regular host should be here in a few minutes. They're taking a little bit of time there, but it should be all right. We have more time than usual. Usually our radio show is from Thursdays at 3:30 to 4:30, but because of the Thanksgiving week, we have to reschedule. This is going to be a good Thanksgiving week. We have two guests right now. I'd like for them to introduce themselves one at a time, their major, their beliefs, or just what they really want to do. We're going to start with Chooks. Yeah. Go right ahead.
My name is Chukwuma Dukwe. I'm Nigerian. Most people know me as Chooks, or Big Chooks. I'm a philosophy major, a minor in chemistry, and... this is my final year at Lehman College. I mostly love playing basketball, writing poetry, and living life.
Nice. You won a championship for Lehman College, didn't you?
Yeah, the ECACs. That was last year.
That's good. You're going to be doing some poetry for us, right?
Yeah, most definitely.
Sounds good. Once in a while, we're going to be doing some book reviews and poetry, folks, so that should be really good. Our next guest.
Hey, everyone. My name is Trent Love. I am a multimedia journalism broadcast major here at Lehman, and I am working on minoring, declaring a minor in music. I am also part of the student government, legislative body here at Lehman as a senator, and proud to represent everyone here in the community as well. I am also additionally a retired captain of the Army, and I continue to serve the community in a capacity that I can, and decided to come back to Lehman College to further my education and skills and develop them to enhance the community at large.
Sounds great. I've been wanting to get a veteran on the show for a while, and we're really glad to have you on. Like, your perspectives are great.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay. Folks, if you want to email us or about any questions or concerns, or just if you'd like to contribute to the show, please email us at weeklyscholar@yahoo.com. Weeklyscholar@yahoo.com. All right. Chooks, I'd like to begin with you. Would you like to say a poem or two, just showing your work?
Oh, yeah. This first piece is something that I wrote recently. Usually, like, most of my poems have been love poems and all that, but like, I feel like I should be moving towards a direction of more inspirational stuff. So I recently wrote something that is supposed to like make people feel a little bit differently. Like, I don't know if any other any folks that haven't seen me perform before are listening, so, but this is like a different feel from what I usually do. This piece is called Superhero. It goes like this. Look up to the skies. Is it a plane? Is it a bird? Is it a kite? No, it's just me. That tall black guy with a mic and a dream. and the mind state of a king, with a voice that could sing and speak words so prime, so divine, that you would have to close your ears and open the windows of your soul just so you could hear me speak these words of he who sent me. And no, I'm not the son of Krypton. I am something much more, kind of like the son of God, so you cannot stop these rhymes with red, blue, or green kryptonites. My words shine bright like the light from a full moon on a pitch black night during winter season. When your mind, body, and soul is freezing, I spit those rhymes that keep you warm. That chicken noodle soup for your soul that makes you wanna lick your fingers and eat the bowl. And this is my goal, to let you know the superheroes don't need capes to fly or shoot fire from their eye. They could grab mics and speak words like it was said in the beginning. Let there be light, let darkness recline to the abyss from which it came. And since the pen is mightier than the sword, then my mic is like a tech nine. And I will stay lyrically trigger happy till every last trace of ignorance is slain. So this right here is a call to arms to all my sisters. Does it love to go against the grain? The iconoclast, the nonconformist, those new age Rosa Parks, so we'll not get off that bus until they give us what we want. And what we want is freedom from all these shackles that hold us down season after season. This is for my brothers with a mindset of Moses that let my people go shit. For men like Medgar Evers, Malcolm, Martin, Mandela, Che Guevara, Fela Kuti, Ken Saro-Wiwa, Marcus Garvey. And on those nights when your soul feels down and heavy, just look up to the signs and the skies and be reminded that I was born to do this. Go ahead, check my Punnett square, because somewhere within those hydrogen bonds in my double helix, it is written he was born to spit poems, born to speak words to enlighten a generation and bringing the revelation of knowledge upon the nation. I'm cooking that food for thought for my people, patiently waiting, the steady searching for knowledge. I'm here to give them what they need, the truth, that same truth that sets free. Open up the blindfolds from the eyes and they see that a life without wisdom is void. It is empty. It is like a song without rhythm, like love without sex, pop music without Whitney, like a hole in your chest that needs to be filled. Broken bones need to be healed and made whole again. And so I stand here like Ezekiel in the valley of the dry bones, and I'm screaming, rise my people. Let's take it back to the days when we were kings and queens and ruled this earth, before the days of the free at last. Free at last, and God Almighty, we are free at last. Let's break the hourglass and with the sands of time rebuild the pyramids and take back our wealth of knowledge. And I pray you find the courage to cast away your bliss of ignorance and take a glimpse of that paradise that can only be attained by a shift of paradigms. For what use was it to break these chains if they could still enslave your state of mind? So look up to the skies. Is it a bird? Is it a plane? Is it a kite? No, it's just me, that tall black guy with a mic and a dream.
Wow. Oh my God. What inspired you to write that, man?
Right, that right there, like, I've been working on that piece for like 3 months prior. And like it was usually we have this show called Roma Does Benefit Show that my friend does, Sigma Faro. And like last year it was always like I told you, it was always most of the poems I had, like the only inspirational poem or something that was a little bit different from love poems was a piece I had called April Showers that had to do with me being in this country for a while and missing Nigeria and all that. But I really needed to move away from writing like lovey mushy poems and all that. Like I needed to go to a different direction. So I decided to write something, and that's what came out, I guess.
Ah, wow. Sounds great, man. Wow. I can't even remember it at all. Like, there's no way I'd be able to remember a whole poem like that, so I congratulate you. What was your reaction?
Well, my reaction, this is Trent, my reaction was that was very impressive. And not only this is a visual thing on the radio, but I could say honestly, It's good and refreshing to see this young man spit such deep lyrics without the aid of any visual cues, a phone, or anything. I'm just telling you, this is as real as it comes. And you may not have been able to see the amount of expression on his face, but I'm more than certain you were able to feel that and hear that in the voice and the way that he brought it. So I appreciate that. That was refreshing.
Definitely. I'm a writer myself, and I like writing poetry. I've been writing a book for over a year now, but the type of work that you do, I'm just amazed right now.
Thank you so much.
We know you have a lot more. We're going to ask you to do another poem, but right now we're going to do a couple more topics. Are you guys okay with that?
Yeah, sure.
Sweet. Well, as you know, tomorrow will be Thanksgiving. How are you going to be spending your Thanksgivings, and how do you feel right now about it? Anyone, just jump at it.
I'll hop in. I'm going to be spending it personally with family and close loved ones, very small, very intimate, because I appreciate the gift of life. And right now, appreciating my family and health as it is. My mother has cancer, and
I'm very sorry.
And she's dealing well. Oh, thank you. But she's dealing very well with it. She's going through. It's a long process. It's like it's not a relay race. It's a marathon. But she's coming along, and she's a fighter. She not only has cancer. She had she needed a double knee replacement in the midst of finding out. Getting surgery on one knee, she found out she had cancer while recovering from that and went through a series of treatment, all while she still needed the surgery on her second knee. Upon getting cancer treatments, she discovered that they were more discoveries. So she's been going through this for several months, and the family's been pulling together. So we all realize and appreciate everyone's worth, whether young or old, and the time that we spend on this earth together to make it count. So this is a very special time that she is now at a point where she is able to get a little bit of a break for a couple of months between her next treatments, because she's actually responding positively. So we're all celebrating each other's presence together, and we're just gonna stay at home, share each other's company, take pictures, listen to music as we usually do, and reminisce and tell old stories.
Wow, that sounds great. I'm really happy for your mom, and just I'll be praying for her, definitely. Trix is you.
Myself, like this year, I have so many things to be grateful for. Almost graduating from college, and life and God has been good to me. So in the spirit of Thanksgiving, instead of like I will spend most of the day with my family, but in the morning I'm going over to a Freemason lodge in Harlem. I have a frat brother that's a Freemason. Mm-hmm. And they're going to set up a little bit of a soup kitchen over there. So me and a couple of people are going to head over there in the morning and give out food to those who are in need. And after that, I get back home. Hopefully, the food should be done in my house by then, so we get a shower now. So,
wow, that sounds like a lot. I'm glad you're doing a lot of community service. It sounds, folks, we should be thankful for the things that we have right now and just the people that are in our lives right now. How does it feel, like, what's your Thanksgiving like? How do you feel like being surrounded by your family, or just, like, what, just tell me what it's like for you guys.
Well, it feels really good to be able to have people physically and presently there, but And I am happy about that, but I never forget the service and sacrifice of others that aren't able to be there. Or my sister, she died, and there are soldiers still overseas fighting. You know, it is Thanksgiving, but, you know, we are still not at a peacetime, technically. So I remember the people that are physically at the table and those that we share in memory and hold the space for as well. And I think that's important. And what this young man mentioned is important as well. Helping and giving back to the community, giving back to those less fortunate, and taking the time to do that if you can, or at least acknowledge that, is very important during this holiday and the Christmas season. And just, this is the season to be doing it. We should be doing it every year, every day, but more so now, because this is what the world needs. The same way we get together around the table, not getting political about it at all, but as a nation, as a people, that same spirit of unity can change the world. We've seen it before. We'll see it again.
Yeah. If you could say anything to our brothers and sisters in Iraq and Afghanistan for Thanksgiving or just the holidays, what would you say to them?
I would say that we're always thinking about you. We love you. We miss you. And we appreciate you sometimes. And I've been in the overseas part, too. A lot of young soldiers and sailors don't really get the message directly, and they're too busy doing the day-to-day mission that they need to do to survive. And it's very important to know that they have the community and the people support rather than what they may see or hear in the community, in the media, in the community that can sometimes wax and wane, but, you know, they've taken a call to duty, and their service, they're doing a great job. They're doing whatever they need to do that they were committed to do in order to be able to come home. But I appreciate their service. We appreciate their services, and also for the families of those that have lost, and the mothers that have lost, and the brothers, sisters, fathers, anybody, aunts, uncles that are serving that have fallen. Their service and sacrifice is acknowledged as well. So I would just say, thank goodness there's a call to bring more troops home, and there are still troops out in harm's way. But in the meantime, just let it be known that we care about you, we miss you, we love you, and come home right away.
Mm-hmm. For me, how it feels to be around my family in Thanksgiving isn't a very amazing feeling. I consider myself very lucky because, like, I have a close knit family, like my immediate family, my brother, my sister, and my mother. My dad died like when I was 4, but like the family that I have over here, we don't usually need Thanksgiving to have this kind of dinner, but like I always love like an occasion to make it a more grandiose celebration. Like usually it's just always like dinner, breakfast. We make it a point to have those meals when everyone is at home. But in the case of Thanksgiving, like it's a bigger celebration, and the food and everything is much more delicious when it comes to those occasions, because like
you put
extra work in to make those foods at those point in time. So I'm definitely looking forward to it. I can't wait for the night to be over. So by tomorrow, once I'm serving those food over there at the soup kitchen, that will be all that's going to my mind to be done and do my service to the community and to just get home and get to that family unit that I have. It's a very amazing feeling. And my heart goes out to those, like, I have a bunch of friends that, like when they tell me their life stories and like how their family is not as close as this, like I feel for them, because like it's something that you have to experience to be able to understand. And like the family unit is a very important thing in the forming of a man or a woman. Mm-hmm. And I think that is something that we should as a community go back to have a home. To have a home is an amazing thing, and there's some times when I'm hanging out with friends, and I'm like at some point in time I'll be like, all right, I gotta go home now, and they're like, I'm like, yeah, I love you guys, but I still gotta go home because, like, there's something that's drawing me back home. Mm-hmm. There's that love right there. And I know not everyone experiences that, and I feel like every human being should be able to have that kind of relationship in their family.
Yeah. Folks, I've done a lot of community service over the years. I've volunteered at numerous soup kitchens, and I've encountered a lot of veterans from multiple wars, as well as, like, many homeless right now. How do you guys feel about those who are suffering at Thanksgiving right now, who are veterans of the Iraq and Afghanistan wars and other wars, or who are just homeless and are trying, but it's just getting really hard? Let's go with our veteran first, if you'd like to.
Sure. Well, I really wish that I personally had the capacity to be able to accommodate everyone physically. I mean, it's a shame to be able to not have a place, and it's tough. Homelessness, especially within veterans, is a problem, and there are thousands upon thousands of troops coming back. Some with may discover they don't have a place to go as well, or it's a strain on the family too. They come back, and the marriages or the family unit that they had intact before, the situation has changed because you've changed, the soldiers changed, and the family changed, and the situation changed. So it is a difficult time during the holidays, more so when you have a surge of troops that are supposed to be coming back during the same time, and a strain on the services and a hard economic downturn as well complicates it. So make a long story short, I think there needs to be more programs, but it would be safe to say, regardless of their background, whether they're a veteran or not, it's important to remember that we're all connected as well, and as a person, as a human being, if you have the capacity or the will or the means and the space to be able to accommodate somebody else onto your table, that you can personally touch their lives, by all means, do so. If I personally had the space, I would be doing more, but I'm planning on doing that in the future. But we all can make a difference.
Explain more. What are you planning to do in the future?
Well, I have some service projects that are in the works for 2012 that would be able to help veterans. One project in particular is a show, a radio and television show called Vetch Chat, where I'll be doing one-on-one interviews and coming up with programs to be able to help veterans, families, fathers, mothers, or what have you, with the connections that I have, even things that deal with immigration and second languages and English and several other ways that can enhance the family structure, because it's really there is an unsung hero in there. We speak about veterans, but I think there's an unsung hero that the support structure in family is vital of being the backbone, and there's a lot of family, brothers, sister, fathers, mothers, that support. It's not one person out there alone. So yes, the veterans serve, but it's a family unit. When we went back to that, that's what makes it so special. It's a family unit, and it's a community thing, because we all rely on one another, the family, the nation, the community, and the person. So as much as we may think that we're that much different and not connected to the next person across of us because they may look different, if you've served or you've been a part of that, that notion quickly goes away when your life is on the line, and we all have to fight for our being and the person's next to us, and we really are focused in our mentality of just staying connected as humans.
Trix, how do you feel?
Yeah, so piggyback of what he said, I think he's right when he says that programs should be put in place for people who are coming back. There is a need for a readjustment program. When you have people who have been fighting overseas, like, they don't have exactly that kind of expertise that they need to go directly into the job system that we have over here. So when they're coming back, that period of time where they have to reassimilate themselves to the society, there should be programs to help them in that case, and also programs to help with psychological mind states that you have after coming back from war is not the same. Like, that, it puts a strain on the family, it puts a strain on family relationships, and it puts a strain on the way you interact with the society. And sometimes it all adds up to the point where you say, okay, how come this guy went from this point of being stable to this point of now living in the streets, right? It's all a chain reaction.
Yeah, it didn't happen overnight, you're right.
Yeah, it doesn't happen overnight. So there is a need for the government to look into programs that will help these guys as they come back to be able to reassimilate themselves to the society and be successful in doing so. I can't sit here and say that I know exactly what it should be or how it should be run. I'm not an expert in those programs, but there is definitely a need for such programs to put in place.
And to piggyback off of that real quick, is just that because there's a lot of synergy happening here, and I know I'm within the room with people that are community-minded, and just for local resources, just as a thought of advocacy, because I would like to advocate too, there is a space available. There's where we are on the beautiful Lehman campus. Right across the street is the Kingsbridge Armory, which is a landmark, and they have talked about using that for a commercial mall and other things, and they're still not decided what they can do with that. I'm not necessarily sure of what they plan to do for that, but that would be a good part that can be an asset to the community in terms of being able to accommodate some of those returning veterans within the plan that we know that they're coming back. Where they're going, we don't know. But we know that they're kind of coming back, and I can speak for myself. I changed, and I'm a veteran. I'm retired. I am numerically young, but
What are you a veteran of? What wars?
Iraqi Freedom. Oh. OIF 1 and 2, I was there for the combat part, and I was there for the peace part. So it was kind of weird, you know, doing two types of totally opposite type of missions during the same interval, so 1 and 2. But I myself suffer with disabilities of post-traumatic stress and adjustment and readjustment, and what he said is exactly correct. And you can look at someone physically and say that they might not change, but within yourself, you've learned more things about yourself, and people see you as different. So it is an important recognition and process to, you know, have those services available.
Definitely. I totally agree. We're going to get back to the topic of veterans in a minute. I'd like to just say a couple of words before we take a quick break. I remember hearing a story once when I was in Wisconsin about a former dentist. So it was this homeless guy, and one of my friends was cooking food and giving food to people. And all of a sudden, the guy said, "Wow, this is the best meal I've ever had." I think he had chili and a bunch of other like good things to eat. And my friend, he's a great cook. I'm a good cook, but he's better than me. So, wow. So he was eating the food, and he was great. And then my friend asked him, "Well, why are you homeless? Is it lack of education? Is it lack of other things?" And he said, "No, I used to be a dentist. I used to have millions of dollars and all that stuff, big houses, a wife and kids and everything. And all of a sudden, he started using drugs. He used drugs for a lot of his life. He used crack and cocaine and all those things. And all of a sudden, he just lost everything. His license to practice, his degree was worthless. He was a drug addict for a long, a lot of period, a big period of time. and he ended up homeless, and he doesn't have a home right now. He's not really doing well. But on Thanksgiving, like, that man should have a meal, and he is thankful for all the meals he gets, and he is trying to help his, like, help his situation. I'm just hoping that more people who are homeless or just suffering during Thanksgiving get a chance to really help themselves or eat a good meal like they used to, or get a meal that they've never had before and just are thankful so they can keep on going. Anything you guys would like to add for that before we take our little break?
Yeah, like, we could always say the next person can do something, but I feel like if you want change, you should start from yourself. So, like, for instance, like, this is going out to Lehman College students. There is actually a volunteer program called the Lehman Life over here, and you could go check that out in Schuster Hall. I don't remember the exact room, but it's in Schuster. It's on the second floor, and I'm at Dubois is the person in charge of it. So actually I went on a trip with them. They have different trips where you could actually go to different states and help people out. There was a trip that I went with them like 2 years ago over to over the Rhine in Ohio. And we actually helped homeless people out, like in soup kitchens, like in even those that had kids that dropped their kids off at daycare centers. We helped out too, and building projects, all that stuff. So when if you want to help out in your community, you could sign up to those programs, or even if you don't want to do anything with Lehman College, find something in and around where you live. There's always places that look for extra hands to help them. So start off that way, and know that even if you have things to be thankful for this season, there are people who are suffering, there are people that need your help. So reach out and help. So from one person to two people, by the time you know what is going on. I heard something so inspirational yesterday. Someone said this was like, I went to a poetry reading also with a couple of my friends, and the lady said that it took two people to bring it to this earth, right? And there's nothing you could do to pay back those two people. The only thing you could do is to pay forward. So as long as you could at least help two people, but I'm not just telling you to help two people, try to do more than two. The lady said when you help two people or more, you are paying forward. So let that be your mind state, to pay forward, to make an input into the society, something of that nature. So this season, even during Christmas season, not even only Thanksgiving, Christmas, New Year's, any season where you have cause to be joyful, just put a smile on someone's face for a change. That's all I advocate for.
Yeah, definitely. Any bit that you can make a difference personally helps. On the topic of homelessness, this is a plug for a institution that I work with, Renaissance EMS, Education, Music, and Sports. I work with a gentleman that his name is Mr. Bervin Harris. He created a song for New York State. And if you go on the site www.weneedyou.com, you'll hear this song that's inspired, that he was commissioned to write, actually, that deals with homelessness. And ironically, as we talk about this and veterans and homelessness, the situation in the song, that's a beautiful song. Once again, it's www.weneedyoutoday.com. The mother gets into the situation of having a homeless family as a result of the father being a veteran killed in the war, so she couldn't take it anymore, so she started taking trips to the liquor store, which is that slope, that gradual slope of how the family collapses. And they give some interesting figures as well. For example, 7 million people don't have a place needs to sleep tonight. That's a big number.
Yes.
They're homeless, and 1.8 million of them are children. So that's devastating. Those numbers and statistics hits home. So this is a fact. This is a real fact, and especially within a community that we live in, homelessness is high. So that's one thing that I can mention. Taking a look and listen is very motivational. Listen to a song, but all is said at the end of the day, we have to do something about it. But it's a good way to address the issue through music.
Definitely. It's always great to address these issues. We're going to take a quick break. Please enjoy the song. Again, we're playing Vivaldi. We'll have Mozart for you next week, folks. Please have a great Thanksgiving. We'll be back in a few seconds or 1 minute. We hope you've enjoyed the music of Vivaldi. This is WHLC. We're back. I'm your host, Johnny Jones. If you'd like to email us, our email is weeklyscholar@yahoo.com. Weeklyscholar@yahoo.com, folks. So we've talked about the issue of homelessness. Is there any last thoughts on that before we move on? Or have we talked about everything that you think is sufficient?
I don't think we've, I'm not going to beat it up. I don't think we've talked about, we've done enough. I kind of feel this is an important time to address, and hopefully we can get some things in place in the community and work together to get to address the issue and problems, especially in the Bronx, or strategize and
bring this topic back up in the program and take some calls or get some insight from the community. If we need to have a roundtable or an action committee or a plan to make a difference, we by all means have the interest, but I don't think any one person can do it alone. So if you have a continued dialogue on it, just feel free to invite me back in, and I'd love to share.
Definitely. Sorry, folks, we're having a little bit of an emergency right now. Give me a couple of seconds. We'll be right back. All right, we're back, folks. Sorry about that. We're having a little bit of technical difficulty today. There's one more thing I wanted to go over with homelessness. So sometimes I serve in soup kitchens. I mostly do it at POTS, Part of the Solution, at Fordham Road. But I do some other community service at other places. And sometimes I meet people who don't actually need the food. Sometimes I've encountered drug dealers or gang members who are coming in to eat food. And they're usually, like, I can smell marijuana in them or just other drugs. And I'm like, what are you doing here? You have enough money to buy drugs. Why are you here? Why are you not buying food? And it just drives me mad at times. What do you think? Is that a good reaction to it, or should I be thinking more outside the box? Let's go with you, Chucks.
Actually, like I said before, like I had a program that I did at Over the Rhine with the volunteer program here at school. One of the things that they told us, like one of the most important things that they told us when we were having orientation with them and briefings, was like, regardless, like that the main thing that could push away someone that you are trying to help is if you go from with a mind state of passing judgments from the gates. So even when you not just the passing judgments like, oh, you have money to buy drugs but you don't have money to buy food. They could see that right up front. These people are not stupid. These people are smart people, regardless of the fact that they're homeless. These people are smart people, intelligence. They could know when you are genuinely trying to help them and when you were just like, oh, it's something that I have to do, maybe for your resume. Or they sense that vibe from you. So I would suggest that, regardless of whatever preconceived notions that you have, just go in there with the mindset that I'm trying to help this person. I'm seeing this person as a human being, not as a drug dealer, not as a drug user, but as a human being. There's some things that you could overcome with only love. So like when you are someone who is in charge or who is in a position to help someone, maybe serving as in the soup kitchen, and you see someone walk in and maybe, like you said, smelling of marijuana and all that, still do your duties to the person without that mindset. See the person first as a human being before any other thing. That's the suggestion that I would give.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
I think that, I would be similar in that mindset if I was in a position to be serving food. Or drink or what have you. I would make it available to them if that's what I needed to do. And I've learned to be more open-minded, and through my own personal experience, things aren't always what they seem. If mm-hmm. someone made a choice of what they're going to do with whatever dime that they have, the fact is if they're coming there because they're hungry, I would accommodate of that and be conscientious and maybe give them another referral if I can, if I suspect that they might have another problem or referral, or connect them with someone to get help with those, because sometimes things are not as so that they seem. And there's a lot more to the issue than just that. But if they're coming as a, you know, to get some food and I could give it to them, I'll do that. And if I see there's other issues, maybe I'd take my own. It's probably beyond what I'm there to do, but if I have a resource, I don't mind giving it out because it'll help the other person, which ultimately a lot of people don't realize, hey, we are a step away from being in their shoes too. Oh, yeah. Not for nothing, between economy and everything else, you know, I don't look down at somebody's situation, because that's what it is a situation. And you can be in their situation next week, tomorrow. You never know what life has in store and how things can change, and you don't have the support structure, and you could be that person down and be looking for that helping hand. So I always extend it.
Yeah, definitely. I definitely agree. I have a friend who used to be a drug dealer. He used to be on drugs as well, and like he would come by the soup kitchen all the time, like just needing food. And I'd always, at first, I looked down on him for a long time, but I just kept on feeding him. I kept on giving him food. I kept on giving him good service, good smile, and just like, I hope, like at night, I hope, be praying for him a little bit to just hope that he does well. And like he's been off his stuff for a little while, and he's been trying to make amends and just do the best he can. So, folks, like if anybody's hungry, it doesn't matter who they are. Yeah, I think it's, you gotta feed them. You gotta, especially for Thanksgiving, they need a good meal. They need some turkey or ham or something like that, you know. Some pie, definitely some pie. Pumpkin pie, sweet potato pie, that's always a great thing to have in America. So we're gonna get off that topic. So before we get off that topic, for veterans, we do support you, we do love you, we do wish you the very best, and we're definitely fighting for you. There is a lot of us who are fighting for you and hope that we get you everything you need for all the sacrifices that you have made. What are the challenges for veterans coming home? Because Obama has pledged that all of the soldiers from Iraq, or a majority of them, will come home by December. So, what are your thoughts on that?
It's going to be a it's going to be a lot of strain on the community, but I mean, we welcome that with open arms. If anything, that's a happy problem for those that may find themselves in the case of being homeless. Actually, within this area, there's a project called Jericho Project, and thank goodness for the smartphone. I've been, you know, just kind of coming up with referrals or for people that may need it, and it's a newly developed housing for homeless veterans that's off of Fordham Road, and you can find out how to get these spaces on. The qualification is a homeless veteran, but it's a place where if you find yourself, especially around the holidays or whatever it might be, in a situation of facing eviction or homeless or being homeless, you can find out more information. It's off Fordham Road, Jericho Project. I just wanted to throw that one out there.
All right, sounds great. I guess it's time to move on. We're going to get into a more heavier topic today. The other day, I was just sitting down, and I was just talking with a colleague of mine. And all of a sudden, a woman comes in, and she's talking, and she seems pretty nice, but she keeps on using the N-word consistently. And she's a Caucasian female, and like, I don't like it no matter what race you are. I just don't like that word used consistently. And the other guys around her are consistently using it as well. They're of other races, mixed races. But I was highly offended by it, just really highly offended by it. And it kind of, she justified it. Using it, she said, "Well, I use it in front of my friends." Da, 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 da. And I still felt uncomfortable around it. It was just something I didn't like, and I just don't appreciate. So, what are you guys' thoughts on that?
Well, this issue is one of those issues that is like never ending. To me, like, I grew up in Nigeria, right? So when I got here, so I was actually new to a whole bunch of concepts like racism and all that. But back in Nigeria, I used to hear all this in the rap songs. You know, it was hip to like listen to all this rappers. I was conversant with most of them, so listening to music, and I used to hear all the word used. But to me, like, what I've seen is that the use now is like when someone has over the years been calling you something, right? And then all of a sudden you decide that instead of making that word that it's supposed to, that word that is supposed to bring you down, you kind of like want to use it as an empowering tool. Like, I'm not going to sit down and
take a quick commercial break real quick. Sorry, this has been more consistent than usual, but we're having a lot of technical difficulties here. Well, we do apologize. Continue, Chucks.
Oh yeah, like I was saying, I'm not gonna sit down and say it's right, but I feel this is the reason why people do it now, why people talk that way and use the N-word now. Is like you've said, instead of sitting down and letting this word that you've constantly used as a tool to bring me down, all right, I'm gonna just use this word and transform it and use it in a different context. Like most people, like that use those words, aren't actually using it to say like most people that use it now aren't using it in the terms that it was used back then. But still, like, I understand that it would hurt a lot of people who are conscious about the reason why that word was brought up or formed. But nowadays, people just use that word and the N-word unconsciously. It's just like it's just like a word that you just throw in conversations without actually thinking deep. But for people who are self-conscious, I feel like whenever you hear it, it brings back history to you. But people who use it randomly and use it whenever they want to, just see it as a regular word. Like sometimes they even use it as a term of endearment. Like, that's my, you know, you fill in the blank right there. So I don't know. Like it's different for different people. Like you said, it might be something. It is something that one of your pet peeves is something that you don't like per se. But to some people, it is something. It is a word that they are conversant with. So, I mean, we live in a world that advocates freedom of speech. I'm not gonna sit and say, oh, you can't actually ban someone from saying those words, but. This question has no simple answer to it.
No,
it doesn't.
And that's what we do.
He's stirring the pot, but he knows he is.
That's what we do on this show.
That's one of those questions that. But I would say to anyone who uses the word, just know your history.
Yeah.
Know your history, educate yourself, and at the end of the day, if you still think you should use the word after you know the reason why the word was there, and then it now comes down to personal responsibility.
Mm-hmm. As well as just know the people who are around you. I mean, in the areas where I've just been around, it was not used as a good word. It was just, it was highly offensive. It was just not, this is not something that you use. And like when I hear it, it's just like, wow, I just totally uncomfortable. It's just like, you know what? I just start building a wall. I'm just like, I can't talk to this person anymore. Anything else on this particular topic?
And I'm keep it to 2 minutes.
Okay.
Really, but this is the type of thing that could be go on and on. Mm. But knowing the history of the word, knowing where it comes from, but most importantly, I have a child in this world, and since I've had a child, my perspective has changed greatly, and my sense of responsibility and what that may mean to my child and their self-esteem. Makes a difference. So I choose not to use the word. I choose not to embrace it. And I do know some people may use it, and that's okay if they don't feel offended by it. But I think the key word is knowing when to use it and respecting those that are offended by it, such as you know, whether it's between blacks and blacks or blacks and non-blacks or what have you, being black doesn't give everyone a free card to use it just as much as not being black, which is a separate issue because they hear someone else use it. But how could you expect someone else to abide by rules that you don't even commit to? And that goes on to being offended with even other issues such as saggy pants or the SAG movement, which some people say is a fashion statement, whatever happened. I'm stirring the pot, too. I'm doing a stir. That could be offensive to some people, too, or not, or as a fashion trend. But if you are offended, that's when it makes a difference. It's like the sneakers with Run DMC. Oh, that was a fashion style. But, yeah, that didn't offend anybody. But me seeing your privates or your underwear, and I'm there in the train, and you pushing your stuff in front of me, and I'm there with my child, that makes a difference to me. And, I'm offended. And I'm going to tell you I'm offended. So I'm that type of person, but not everybody will. So if it offends you, voice it and take heed and respect that, because not everybody embraces it the same way. And if you look at the history of the word and everything else and even the movement, if you look the word sagging and you spell that backwards, you're going to be looking at the same situation or issue that we're talking about right now. Yeah. People have died for us to change that imagery of what we say and how we project ourselves. And we're not doing any service by perpetuating it.
I mean, when it comes to pulling your pants down and stuff like that, or just... what do you call it?
Girls, too. They could pull their shirts down, too. Yeah. I'm offended by some females I see doing the same or similar just as much.
Yeah. But the original meaning of that, and it took me a long while to just research that and all that stuff, it comes from prison, but it doesn't mean what a lot of people think it means. A lot of people think it means it's a cool thing, but it means one or two things. It either means that you want some in the prison system or that you belong to somebody. So I look at that as like a lot of people are perpetuating that, and it's just like, oh my God. Like whenever I see somebody sagging, that's the first thing that pops up in my mind, and I'm just like, oh my God, really?
They've made a fashion out of it, and people are profiting off of it, making music videos, and I understand it's important to look like you in style and fashion and everything else. There's a lot of peer pressure to fit in, mm-hmm. but is that the message that we want to be sending? You know, we have a choice in that matter. We're consumers, you know, so we have a, if you know, you feel offended, by all means, look for an alternate.
Sounds good.
I wear a belt, put it that way.
I thank you, my friend. I thank you. Once in a while, folks, we'll do a little bit of a book review. We're not going to do a big book review, but I've been reading a book for a while. It's called Words of Wisdom, Philosophy's Most Important Quotations and Their Meanings. Gareth Southwell. I really enjoy this book. It's not a book where you could just read it all day and you'll be done, no. It's a book you really have to take time with, and it's just tons of quotes from philosophers and just great men. Here's a small quote for you, and we'll just go from there. But just, what do you think? The examined life is not worth living. Socrates and Plato, Apology. I could read more, but I guess we'll get to that if you guys want to. But what do you think about the unexamined life is not worth living? What do you guys think?
That was from Socrates,
Socrates,
right?
Yes. In Plato,
oh yeah. Yeah, he's actually one of my favorite philosophers.
Same here.
Yeah. The unexamined life is the same thing with any, like running any organization or doing anything in life. Like if you don't sit back to have a progress report of how far you've come, of how your actions have affected outcomes, you might keep on making the same mistakes over and over again. So, you know what they say about insanity is just doing the same thing over and over again and expecting different results. So, at some point in your life, you have to, at some point, if you don't do it like every day, at least once a month or once a week, you have to sit back and think. You have to think and reflect on how your actions have affected your results, and see how you could change things to make a better you.
What are some things you guys have learned through just reflection in your lives?
Oh, Lord, I just came back from reflection, and I took a 7-day cruise to the Caribbean just because I really felt I needed it
right now.
To refresh myself for this final week and finish up the semester. So, reflection is very important. Now, the most successful people in business or in society make it a point of business to take that time and get away and reflect, and then come back with a new perspective. And every time I do that, that really helps me identify what is the most important priorities in my life, and evaluate and see how far I've come, evaluate my goals, and look at my life's plans. And like when you get lost on your navigating system, and they have to recalculate or, you know, tell you, reroute how to get back on your game plan. That's important because you can't see the forest from the trees sometimes. So it's essential.
Definitely.
Yeah. For me, like, I don't have the kind of money he has to go on a cruise to reflect, but, you know, I go to a quiet place, like, shut the world out and, you know, think. Because sometimes, like, it's good to be around people. It's good to have a whole lot of friends, but that doesn't afford you the time to have deep thoughts. It doesn't give you the atmosphere that you need to be able to carry out that kind of exercise. So once in a while, I don't put it like as a routine. It's not carved in stone. Like, here, this is the day I'm gonna go and reflect. But like when the opportunity presents itself and I'm done with schoolwork and I'm done with things that need to be done, I clear my mind, just maybe listen to one of my, not rap music, but like one of the something like you've been playing during the intermission, you know, that's just soothing music right there. And you can sit back and think about stuff. There's a lot of things you could think about. There's a lot of there's a lot of times I've sat back and I've thought and in different situations and I've said, oh, this is what I did wrong, this is what I need to fix, and not just thinking about the past but also plotting how the future should be, because there's a lot of things that I've thought about and made plans, and a lot of times when those situations come up, I see that the plans that I made have actually helped me in the way that I respond to those scenarios playing out. So it's a very important thing to do.
Sounds really good. They say that when you walk in a forest and you leave tracks, that the first time you've ever really examined those tracks are when you come back to them. And I think that's really true. Looking out on life, folks, like, you can be very goal-oriented with your life and just want to accomplish things left and right, but I think it's true what they say. If you're not really living life and enjoying things moment to moment, or just like being present at the moment, then and living things goal to goal, then you're not really living life at all. And we should really take that time to find value in the people around us and the things around us, and just go from there and remember that, because by the time you get to your goal, you're happy that you've gotten your goal, but also you remember all the good things that happened to you or all the hardship that you had to go through, and you see the person you are now because of it. In your lives, have you guys seen that, or have you guys taken time to just reflect on what you've done in your lives?
Well, I make a point of doing it regularly, because I got a lot on my plate. So, and that's really what makes me appreciate life more. So for me, regularly is a once a quarter. At least dedicate a time within every couple of months to see where I'm at. And it works for me. That's what I've do. But I've learned to do that, and I've listened to some people, some wise people, that have mentored me along the way and helped me. And that's what they do, and kind of that's what I do. Sometimes we even do it together.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like I said before, I don't have a time, like a schedule for it, but I would say in the past like year, in this past year, the year is almost over. Like in the past year, I've done it like in a month, probably like twice or thereabout as an average or so. But it's not just about the past too. Like I was talking about, it's also about the future. My mom told me a story about his uncle, right? That he actually wrote like brought a piece of a book, right? Mm-hmm. And then he wrote down dates, not like dates specifically, but like moments at what age he wants to do something, right? He wrote down the ages he wanted to get married, ages he wanted to have this amount of money in his bank account, and he wrote down how he planned to do it. And then when that time comes, he brings out the books and he checks out the things that he was able to achieve. And those he wasn't able to achieve, he doubles his effort in those areas. So if you are the kind of person that if you have a mental list of what you want to do and you tend to forget them, just write down something somewhere that you're not going to lose it, somewhere that you always going to go back to it and hold yourself accountable, like, okay, I did this, I got this, I got this, this is what I need to do. Like you have to have, and also maybe have someone who will hold you accountable for fulfilling those goals that you set to yourself.
Well, expand on that. Both of you, who have been mentors in your lives, if you've been able to have them?
Oh, I don't want to. I do want to say a lot of people, mm-hmm. but I won't, because I probably at different points won't remember all their names, but I am appreciative because I do know that they've had a profound impact in my life and developed me to the person I am today. So various, many, and from, I'll mention at least a program here and now. When I was going through high school, there was a program called En-ROADS, and they still help high school students transition people of color into the business world. And this is my second degree. My first degree was in business management, and I was looking at accounting. So that was a program that introduced me to the concept of a mentor, which I had during that time. In the military, I've had various mentors, some of which were paired up with me, some of which I sought out proactively. Currently, with on campus here and the Urban Male Leadership, I've just got notified that Clarence Stanley in the small business development area is one of my mentor. But a mentor could be anyone whom could be helpful, get to where you want to go. And like he said previously, there was another test called the Tombstone Test that helps me keep focus and live your life backwards. If you think of whatever it is that you want to do instead of planning forward, which was one concept that was given, I plan backwards. I plan backwards, as morbid as it might sound, like what would, you know, and I actually done this, including a will and everything else that goes, what would you want somebody to say? What would you want on your tombstone? And how would you want to be recognized and realized upon, you know, upon death? What would you want on your tombstone to people to say or think about you and live your life backwards? And that's an interesting concept, and that's what helps me navigate and keeps me online with where I want to go and all these things leading to that final goal. So mentors, I think, are very important and key to success.
Myself, I haven't had like a mentor per se, like someone official, but I would say my mom has been influential in my life, like the kind of person that I've turned out to be. Like it's just like this woman just molded me into this perfect specimen of a man. But like I haven't, like my dad died when I was a young kid, so I haven't had that. The only male figure that I've had, like, was my uncle when my mom came over here, and I had to live with him for a while. So that's one of the people that have shaped me into a man. Like, the idea of the man that he is what I'm aiming for. And also, like, him. And, yeah, I would say mostly him. For me, like, the ideal of a man, that's the person that I look up to. And then my mom is a man and a woman in herself. So, like, she's really helpful in those areas. But when it comes to academics and all that stuff, like, I've always been this kind of person that tries to find answers for myself. Like, I haven't had that figure of a person that I go to and ask questions. I've tried to find answers for myself, and I've seen it's a rewarding way. It's not the perfect way, but it's rewarding, because like when you find answers for yourself, you tend not to forget them when someone doesn't feed you information and stuff. But like, I'm not advocating for everyone to go that route, but like I've had my mom on the side helping me out. But when it comes to academics and all that stuff, I've always been like an independent person.
Gotcha.
Per se.
Do you guys think you'll be better mentors because of these experiences?
I think so. Actually, with this specifically, the Urban Male Leadership program that's available here, I initially did apply to work as a mentor, but being that I prioritized and reprioritized, my time was limited because my mother was ill, I decided to enter the program as a mentee so I can learn the issues and become a better mentor at some point in time later, being more familiar with the program and the needs and and identifying the needs of the local community as well. So I hope to gain an experience and, of course, give back. That's the kind of constant thing. I guess I think that's part of my human nature, is I like to serve.
So. Well, on this show, you're a mentor to all of us here, so we're all glad that you're here and you're just giving us your wisdom.
I appreciate that, man. Mm-hmm.
Like you said, I believe that you actually have to be mentored to know the ropes of how to mentor someone else. Like, you have to have that learning experience of when you ask questions of how the person responded to you. It's like an internship per se, but you learn in the process. I don't know how mine is gonna pan out. You are currently my mentee, but I can't say that I'm a perfect mentor per se, but because I don't have all that. I haven't had that mentor-mentee experience before with someone else. So, you are the first person that I've ever mentored. So we'll see how it works out at the end of the day.
He's still stirring the pot, you got me.
Wow, this is amazing. You're doing a good job so far.
That's important, because between that relationship, regardless of what you know, it could be formal or informal. Mm-hmm. There's usually somebody that knows the ropes a little bit, that's kind of in the inside track, that can help and offer that. And you know, when you want to do something in life that might be new, you're always in a position to give, no matter what it is you do. Everybody comes with experience. Mm-hmm. And it could be something informal or formal. There's big brothers, there's big sisters. Definitely. I mean, or it could be, like I said, a person on the street in the community. You'd be surprised how many people would be honored and flattered just to say, like, hey, you know, I want to be, you know, like you. I want to take some of what you got and instill it within me. And we could pick and choose what qualities we want to take or not, but there's a lot of good in everybody, and everyone has something to offer. Mm-hmm.
Sounds great. We have three more topics over the day. Shouldn't take very long, folks. We thank all you for listening, and also if you'd like to contribute to the show at all, or if you'd like to give some criticisms, please email us at weeklyscholar@yahoo.com. We thank all of our listeners for listening and listening to us. We have hundreds of listeners right now, and we're just very thankful. We'd like to turn our attention to the topic of financial literacy. And this is a good topic for me and just the rest of us, because as I walk around New York City, I see tons of people like wearing like jeans that cost $100 and something, shirts that cost $100 and something, sneakers that cost $300, Jordans, or, you know, the regular. And like, you'll see a bunch of these people who are wearing these things and yet they're broke. Or just, what are we spending our money on? Like, if you could give one tip for people in like good financial literacy, what would you tell them?
I'm a student, right? So I don't have my budget is kind of low.
So, oh yeah,
yeah, it is. It is. But what I usually do is and this is a suggestion that my mom's gave me. You always see me talk about my mom, like, she's an amazing person.
I want to meet her now.
So. So every week I make sure I go to the bank, right, and I take out how much that I think that I need for that week, and I will not touch my debit card, because like, there's something about the debit card. When you swipe, you think you have unlimited money, and you keep swiping. So like, every week I'll be like, all right, this is how much I need for lunch. And like, I don't eat out I don't eat outside the house too much just to save money. But those times where I know that I need to eat out, and I know I need to make some expenses for that week, I take out that the amount of money, and then when it's done, I just live life and make sure I don't spend more for that week. And the next week, I make sure I take out the same the amount of money that I need for that week too, and you know, have a regularly check my bank account, know how much I'm in debit or credit, and make sure I don't go over that, because the bank, they charge you when you go over that amount, and is not a petite amount of money. They go over.
Well, I could keep it as simple as four words: live within your means.
Mm-hmm.
Because everyone's personal situation can vary, and financial literacy is important, and that's part of the reason I'm developing that. That's part of the premises of the Vets Chat show, is you're dealing with family, you're dealing with fitness, and you're also dealing with finance, which is important, because the financial literacy makes a big difference in one's qualities of lives. But as long as you can live within your means, no matter what it is that you have, I don't think it's the money per se. Sometimes it could be an issue of beyond making the basics covered. That's one situation, but as long as you live within your means, you'll be good.
Yeah, definitely. I understand. And like, I've known some people that will try to live beyond their means, and it just doesn't work out. Like, they'll buy way more than they need to. Or I know a couple of veterans who, like, as soon as they got back, they splurged on things, and now they're looking at themselves.
I'm guilty. I did too. I bought a BMW cash. The dealer thought it was crazy. I was crazy. Online, I didn't even see the car. I just ordered it.
How do you feel about that decision now?
I was happy. It was a convertible. Then I got married, had a daughter, and had to choose, like, who's going to be in that convertible. Two-seater. So my priorities changed. But nonetheless, I sacrificed a lot, and I was able to still do that. And I didn't spend anything, really, while I was away, and I was still giving stuff away. How do I feel about it? Yes, it still applies. I live within my means, but I sacrificed a lot to be able to do that.
Yeah. I remember a friend, he wants to buy a house now in Connecticut, and he wanted to buy a house that cost $650,000. And I told him, in this economy, that's a horrible idea. Why would you spend that much money? And I'm looking at the property, I'm like, it's not worth the amount of, like, why would you want to get yourself in a 30-year loan right now? Like, you can easily, like, go to another state or go down south and buy a house for $30,000, maybe $50,000 or $80,000. And it just drives me crazy, because I'm just like, why do you want to keep on emulating people? Why do you always want to appear like you have a lot of money? I appreciate people who live within their means and who just do what they can. And a lot of them seem a lot more happier than the people who try to just keep up with the Joneses, if you know what I mean. Any thoughts?
I work on making it look expensive sometimes, quite often, if they see between the way you either A, present yourself, or spend a lot of time ironing your clothes, that can make a difference on what they perceive as its worth at times. So, yes, I make choices. There are times when I splurge and I feel like it's really, I have to make that kind of investment when necessary. Depends on what it is. But as I'm wearing now, you can't see me. I'm wearing a pair of jeans and a shirt, and I am wearing a tie and a vest, but collectively, and a pair of sneakers, which I'm not ashamed to say, they're from Payless. Buy one, get one half off.
Hey, they're black. Like a great deal to me, man.
And they might have been about like $25. They're not Michael Jordan Nikes, which is nothing wrong with that too. But I practice just living within my needs as much as possible.
Yeah, definitely. We're not a sports show. We're not a sports show at all. But I thought we'd get into this topic a little bit. But the NBA right now is non-existent, and like a lot of people, I miss it. I miss watching basketball and just this whole, like, right now, during the lockout, it's just horrible because people are, a lot of people depend on the NBA for jobs, and they're losing their jobs left and right, or they're unemployed. Some of them are seasonal workers, and some of the NBA players are living paycheck to paycheck, which is amazing to me, because if I got a paycheck that said $1.5 million a year, I mean $1.5 million every 2 weeks, wow.
Living within your means.
Oh, yeah.
They're still Dancing with the Stars, though, so don't worry. Well, not anymore. It should be finished.
But NBA, NFL players do better than NBA players for some reason. I don't know why. But just what? Since we have a former basketball player on here, what do you think? What do you think? What do you think about this?
I think they should get their acts together and give us a, like, what? Right now, I don't have any hope for a season, but like, it would have been great to watch basketball this year. But like, it comes back to what we've been saying. Like, we are in Thanksgiving, and we have a lot of things to be thankful for. But there's families that like you said, their livelihood depend on them having a season. Mm-hmm. And I think regardless of what the differences are, they should have found a way at least to settle that and have those people come to work. There's some people that I believe, there would be people out there that is their sole means of survival. Mm-hmm. That is what they are hinging their hopes on, to be able to feed their families during this time. And now they are all out of jobs. It's like we might be out here thinking, oh, we don't have a basketball season, mm-hmm. or how that sucks. But there's people out there that they're going, oh, we don't have a basketball season, what are we gonna eat? You know, so. This problem didn't just start today. Mm-hmm. It didn't just start last 2 weeks. It's something that they knew they were going to talk about this way before last season was over. All this argument that they're having about who gets what percentage of the income coming in, the players and the managers of the team. So I think it's a bit too selfish on their part.
Yeah.
On both, I'm not laying blame on whoever. I'd say on both parts, for the players and the managers, not to give the fans a season and to deprive people of their means of livelihood.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
It's tough. I think the fans lose out more than anyone, because they are, like he said, the bottom line is deprived of that season. But it's a double-edged sword, you know. I know that as a player, you want to have the fairest deal as possible, whatever it might be, what they deem is fair for their value, for the sport or industry that they're in. And same thing, the management is making money. I can't blame them for, per se, having that kind of conversation or negotiation. It needs to be done. They're going to fight for as much as they can. As far as them being an athlete, they are available to play in other countries and play elsewhere. And by the same token, as a fan, I guess we have to find ourselves, if that's what we really want to watch as far as the season, other ways to pass our time. Unfortunately, they weren't able to reach a quick enough settlement to appease the bottom line of the fans, because that's what's at stake. And we're the ones that pay for the premium for them to be able to have this sport, pay those salaries, eat that food, drink those beers, or, you know, we're the ones that really are the people allowing this to happen. So for us to be not given a season, is, I think you're going to see some consequences somewhere down the road. So yeah. A lot of eyes have been opened. They didn't think this would happen, but it did.
Mm. Definitely. I really miss going home once in a while and like watching a Knicks game or just a TNT game for the NFL, for the NBA, or even listening to Charles Barkley. And this year, Shaquille O'Neal was supposed to be in there, and I'm just like, he's horrible. he takes 10 minutes to get through one point, but I'm like, oh my god, I missed that.
Yeah, but he's a funny guy too.
He's definitely a funny guy. Wow, that's amazing. So I heard the idea of, what would you like on your tombstone, or what would you want your tombstone to say? You two gentlemen here, what would you two like your tombstones to say, like, after all the things you've done? Because once you've died, the world's going to keep on going. But what would you, like, for the random stranger or family member that passes your grave, what would you like your tombstone to say? Or what would you want people to remember you by?
I kept mine simple. Actually, I did write it down, and I do change it, but in some, without writing it, because I wouldn't want to say it and, you know, let it be something etched in stone, because it's not. But the sentiment is an American that cared about helping people and changing the world and making it a better place.
Definitely.
Yeah, that's the reason why I like this guy. Yo, he asks the most deep questions that you.
Yeah, right. It's like, not a normal radio show.
You're not even ready for questions like this.
He ambushed you. It's boom. Okay. I didn't know any of these questions, but it's okay.
Yeah, what would I love my tombstone to say? There's a whole bunch of stuff. You know, you probably just have a couple of lines to say everything that you wanted to, but even Twitter gives you more characters, you know. What would I like?
It's a good dialogue, though, you know. Yeah. That's what you want to leave. Mm-hmm. Catalyst for change is before. Okay. You could be that. You're a catalyst for change because you spark those questions and make people think. So
I'm trying my best here.
Yeah, I could change someone's lives.
Mm-hmm. I would like to say that that I influenced someone else, that I left something in someone's life that made him a more positive person. Like that's what it all comes to. Like, most great people leave legacies behind. Mm-hmm. Like, you hear their stories over and over again. Some people, like, I come from my country, right? Like, mm-hmm.
Your country is?
I'm Nigerian. Mm-hmm. A bunch of people just want that outward influence of wealth. Like, oh, they know he's a politician. He works in an oil factory. He gets this. He gets that. But then there's other people that will do the thing that you're doing now and do it better. There's people that will always get money. There's people that will always have more money than you do. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, you just another person that had money. But there's something about being legendary, about your story continuing. Like, I will always, for instance, my uncle, like, when my mom came here and we needed someone to hold us down, like someone to be there for us until we were able to join her, he was the person that stepped up and said, all right, you come live in my house and I'll raise you guys as my own kid, you know? Mm-hmm. And I will always remember that. Even when I have kids, I will tell them, like, see, the fact that I'm here is because there's someone who cared, right? And that story will always continue, you know? If at the end of the day, your story lives on after you're gone, that's the most important achievement that you could ever have in this life. If you check the history books, all these people that we are constantly teaching their stories to our kids and the kids after them are people who live on by their stories and not just by the wealth that they had, but the influence that they had on society and their story living on after they are dead. So
that's important. He's talking about creating legacies and something to live on. And I think we all have different concepts of success and what that may entail. And I really do believe that we could change the world, but at the same time, I think we really I like to do it in a more intimate way, one person at a time. And even if it starts with myself, you know, I got to get it together, mm-hmm. you know. But we all have that capability of making the world a better place. I believe we all do that inherently. And we shouldn't forget that.
Yeah. For me, it would definitely be like what I want to say in my tombstone is that he tried. That's it. That's all I want, is that he tried. Like, at the end of the day, my legacy, I wanted to be that this guy tried to do the best he could. That this guy tried to leave the world better than what he found it. As well as this guy tried to help when he could. I mean, even it doesn't matter if it was, like, the little things. Like, the little things count a lot. You never know what little things Like, I've met people that when I was in my old academy in high school, where I tried to help people out and get them involved in the community and other things, and then years later meeting them, and they just have so much respect for me for helping them with that. And I'm just like, you know what? Just trying in life makes a big difference, even if you fail. The knowledge that you gave it your all, you gave it your best, is something that just goes a long way at the end of the day. And it is worth it to make an effort, no matter what, because it shows that you're doing the best you can and that at least you had that much passion and that much drive to keep on going and to say that you were passionate about something. I don't think you can leave this life saying that you weren't passionate about anything. Mm-hmm. And that makes a big difference.
Well, if you change that to he did the best he could, because like the word, I don't know, something about the word try makes me think that a person failed, and I don't know, like it sounds. But what if he just goes, he did the best he could?
All right,
I get a sentiment, and it's definitely it's not. I think I understand where you come from the heart, and that's how I started too. I just thought about the message of how it feels, and it's so true. It's showing up, and you know, like you say, I tried, but by the same, technically, that for him, that means him showing up. He's mm-hmm. not just saying, all right, I tried, and all right, I didn't show up. No. It can be connotated or misconstrued as that, but yeah. This is the type of person that, if he says he's trying, he's being modest, mm-hmm. which is something, and humble. Okay. So, you know, I know that within his character for the short time that we've been having this for him. But showing up is a big part of being successful, whether it be big or small, and you'd be so surprised how that makes a difference. I show up to small events, I show up to big events. I show up to any events. I showed up to this event. You know, that shows that there's something within you that cares. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I didn't know what was in store for me. Yeah. Didn't know. But, hey, you know, same thing. I tried. But I'm here. I showed up. So it could mean different things for different people.
Okay.
All right. We're almost out of time, but we have just enough time. I'd like to wish everybody a happy Thanksgiving and eat as much as you can. Watch as much football. Try to enjoy the things you have. Reflect. For a veteran, you can say a few words, and then Chooks, I'd like to leave the show with you saying your last poem of the day, is that okay?
Oh, okay.
Close it out.
All right, go ahead.
Oh, you go first.
Well, to everybody, to all Americans and beyond that, everyone around the world, I really wish this holiday time, spend the time to appreciate one another, share in company, and just know that we're all connected and thinking about it. And there's a special place, you know. Let's remember how important it is to appreciate what we have despite our hard times, that, you know, this is only to make us appreciate what we have. So let's do so.
All right. This last piece that I'm ending is one of my favorite pieces. Like something I wrote after being in this country for a while. I was feeling homesick, so it has a nostalgic feel to it. It's called April Showers. It goes like this. Brown clouds creep up slowly in the clear blue skies, masking daylight with darkness. From a distance, I hear dogs bark, startled by the erratic lightning flashes and thunder clappings, while I sit on the balcony, staring deep into the eyes of the storm, listening with gladness to the rhythmic sounds of raindrops and hailstones as they sing on the rooftops made of corrugated iron sheets. Oh, that wonderful symphony that bears witness to the coming of the first rain. It is said that when the heavens cry, the earth rejoices. One man's tears bring another one joy. Make that a universal law, cause heavenly tears cause life to spring forth. Now sometimes I sit and recall back to the days when I was young, reminisce on the songs that we sang as we played in the rain, that feel of wet grasses on my feet, the taste of cold waters on my lips, and the fragrance of flowers that blows among trees. These are the simple things that I miss, for time brings a change to all things, and innocence is lost with the passing of the seasons, boys tend to men, and in the process lose sync with Mother Nature. So I packed my bags and left home. for a land where rainbows lose its colors and life is seen only through shades of gray, where all we do is sit and pray for God to send us down His grace. But when this world gets cold and my soul gets numb, I close my eyes and dream of home, where brown clouds patiently await my return, like the father of a prodigal son. For once again, spring has sprung, and the teardrops from heaven bring back sweet memories. Words cannot express the joy that I feel when I see raindrops on my windowpane. April showers have come once again to wash away my pain and sorrows. Thank you.
Wow. That was truly amazing, folks. Well, again, we'd like to thank you for tuning in, for hundreds of fans, and just have a good Thanksgiving, and we wish you all the best. And remember to help as many people as you can within your means. The smallest thing can make a big difference. This has been the Weekly Scholar, and we thank you for listening. Have a good Thanksgiving, folks. Bye.